And let's give a big hand to Dick Gourley, please.
You guys hear me? There we go. Hey, it's great to be here in beautiful Chico. And as we get started, the first thing I want to say is thanks for inviting me. But I want to really compliment the community here on Chico Start. And I hope everybody realizes they're doing just an absolutely extraordinary job. So how about a big round of applause for them? So Heather invited me for lunch today. She said there was a little conference going on, but could you join her for lunch? And so I'm your lunch speaker. I'm the only thing is standing between you and lunch. So anyway, when we were talking, I asked Eva, I said, well, why me? And she said, well, we looked at your LinkedIn profile, and it's obvious that you've made a lot of mistakes over your life in the business world. You did it in the corporate world, you did it in the Army, you did it with all your startups. And so she said, that's the reason, and we'd like you to share a few thoughts with this group on things that you might be able to do a little bit different that might help you out a bit. So I am the founder of GorwTECH Leadership. I spent most of my life in corporate America, IBM, Oracle, Adaptech, a lot of tech companies, and then I've done a lot of startups. Over the years, one of the things that happened for me was I had a real side interest in nonprofits. And one of the things that's common with nonprofits is that they're not run very well. Likewise, when I was doing startups, this was like when Guy Kawasaki was just getting started, you know, nobody really knew how to do it. All of us just kind of said, oh, let's give it a shot, and we kept making all these mistakes. And at Oracle, you know, the thought was that the people that had the most t-shirts made the most, you know, for the launches made the most mistakes. So I'm going to tell you a little bit today about four things. First, I'm going to share some thoughts on leadership with you that apply to everybody. Second, I'm going to share some thoughts about how to build a strong foundation for your organization. I'm going to talk a little bit about culture, and then I'm going to finish by talking about the fact that it actually helps you improve your business results, what I'm going to propose for you. So we start here. When leaders and organizations adopt servant leadership, they intentionally put people first and create a positive, trusting, and service-focused culture that enables better business results. How many of you have worked for a startup or a small business that you just hated, where you just could not stand your boss, and nobody thanked you, nobody encouraged you, nobody taught you? It must have hit you hard. So this is why I want to talk about servant leadership, but it's in the context of a whole bunch of stuff here. So this is what we call a vision framework. It was actually developed by Jim Collins, who did Good Great, who I'm a big fan of. And this is actually the vision framework for our company, GorwTECH Leadership. So there's three things that go into a vision framework. The first is core values, because that determines everything you do as an organization. You say, how does it touch your core value? Second is to know your purpose. And your purpose is why you get up every day. Okay? It's like, oh, I want to go down to Chico Start, you know, and be at the meeting today. So our purpose is to help leaders build enduring great organizations, so it's both nonprofit and for-profit. And then the third thing is what we call a BHAG, a big, hairy, audacious goal. It kind of got to be a term that was used during the 60s when they put the man on the moon and Kennedy announced that we're going to do it. And so the big, hairy, audacious goal was his scratch. So our current internal mission is to successfully build and operate Soldek leadership by the end of this year, and we're on track for that. And then the second one is to develop 1,500 servant leaders and establish 375 organizations by 2038. So big, hairy, audacious goal. So what's the situation for most of you? Startups are hard. This is a photo of the base camp for Mount Everest, and the point I'm trying to make here is that before you go climb that mountain, before you go do that startup, you need to bring a team together. Some people will be smart about climbing, some people will be smart about working on supplies, first aid, whatever, but you have to put together a team. And that's one of the areas where people really struggle. So why are startups so hard? First, founders lack experience and leadership skills. Second, they've never heard of a vision framework, so they haven't laid out what their core values are. They're just kind of doing their deal. And similar to what Jeff was saying when he presented, it's kind of a goat rodeo. Third is skipping the customer discovery and validation stage. So that would be the Steve Blank stuff where you get outside the building. I know that for one of the presentations here, there was questions about what are you doing to see what the customer's doing, and that obviously should drive it. Not getting the right people on the bus. So with Colin's case, it's two things. It's get the right people. So they have to be the right people in terms of core values, what their beliefs are, because you want a team that really is in good sync with each other. And then you want to get them in the right seat. I worked with a startup about 2 years ago, a fintech startup, and the founder had hired two people, one to be marketing person and one to be a salesperson. So I was coaching them, and I said, well, tell me a little bit more about the marketing person's qualifications. Well, she doesn't have any experience in marketing. So she's a good friend of mine, and I'm just kind of liking that. So it was clear there was no marketing happening. And then the second one was a really great guy. He was with one of the big four, but he was a project manager. He wasn't supposed, wasn't a salesperson. His idea of sales was checking to see if the latest order came in. Fifth, failing to create a positive and trusting culture. And this is really important for all of us, whether just in life or in business. You want to be with people that you trust, you like, and that provides for positive, healthy relationships. I'm sure there are many of you that have been in companies where you've got a toxic relationship, and it's just nasty. And one of the things I did when I left IBM, I had run the branch office and sales and marketing for the Silicon Valley, and I ended up going to Oracle. And it was not me culturally, but I said, if I can make it there, I can probably make it anywhere. And so I had to learn to be me and not go in for all the brutalness of that culture. And then finally, a lot of folks are not committed to creating what Collins calls an enduring great organization. So Jeff was talking about the different stages, and what you want is you want to get to that last stage where you're thriving, okay? There's no chance that because the economy blips a little bit that you're going to go out of business. So this is a problem statement. This applies to you as well as nonprofits. Many individuals have the desire and expertise to create new organizations, but lack a methodology to build and nurture a successful, enduring, great organization. So there's this big gap there, and all of us have experienced it. It's like you're kind of working on something, and then it's like you just don't get there. So a question, if I were able to show you a simple and affordable way to create, grow, and scale your organization, would you be interested in hearing more? All right. So we're going to start with a really important slide here. When I was at IBM, one of my customers and partners was Intel. They're headquartered in Santa Clara. And so one of the IBM execs from New York came out and they wanted to meet with Andy Grove. And so we're having this discussion and it involved operating software, Windows versus OS 2, and this was the guy in charge of OS 2, which was technically a better product, but we were late to the market. And Andy Grove speaks his mind, and he just basically lit him up, and I'm sitting there going, this is fun. And what he said afterwards to me, he pulled me aside and said, listen, don't do what they're doing, okay? I know what you're doing in the branch. You're doing good things. You're moving from mainframes to engineering workstations. He said, this is his favorite quote. If you don't know where you're going, you might not get there. So one of the things with your startup is to understand where you want to go. Doesn't mean you can't change your mind. Doesn't mean you can't pivot as you're going through the development process. But you really need to be laser focused on getting somewhere. So what's the key to your success? I contend that it's leadership. Leadership is something that is sometimes natural and sometimes it's learned. But Jim Collins, who I referred to before, said the leadership is the art of getting people to want to do what must be done. And the reason I've got the little pictures up here, he was the chair for the study of leadership at West Point, and I went to West Point, and basically what we were teaching us a long time ago was the same thing. So I feel like he's a pretty solid guy on that. So think about leadership. There's a lot of different discussions about leadership and whether it's important or not important. But one of the things that's important is that you understand there's basically two types of leadership. First is model one, which is a power model of leadership. Second is the service model of leadership, which is what we call servant leadership. Okay? So this is the difference in the two. If you look at the first pyramid, you see the white person at the top of the deal there, and the model is top down. Okay, it's about control. It's not about empowering your employees. It's not about trusting them. Okay, and guess what? They never come to you and say, hey, I have a great idea on how we can iterate our business, right? So they would love to help, but the person at the top is just like, I'm in charge, get out of my way. So what servant leadership does is it flips the pyramid and puts the leader at the bottom. And the purpose of the leader is to serve the employees, serve the customers, develop those employees, and create a great culture where the organization just hums. And if for some reason the CEO or whoever was in charge, you know, gets hit by a truck, the organization's not going to fail because they've really got a team. So I want to share with you a case study. How many people have heard of Patagonia? Okay, good. It's a great company. So Patagonia is one of Jim Collins's good to great companies. And he actually worked with them when he was at Stanford still as a professor. So the company was founded in 1973 by Yvonne Chouinard, and it was originally called Lost Arrow. It was a role model. It intended to be a role model for proving the environment. And what he did was, he was a climber initially, and so you'd go up on these rock climbs and they'd be pounding all this stuff into the rocks, basically destroying the environment. So he changed the whole way that technical climbers climb now, so it's non-invasive. The next, he made it clear from the beginning that number one thing was they're focused on serving employees, their customers, and their partners. Okay, so very, very much customer and employee focused. He was always committed to building an enduring great organization. So even though he had no clue that he was going to go into clothing or some of these other areas, he just knew that he wanted the company to last. And today it's a 50-year-old company. It's absolutely thrived over the years. It's got a strong brand promise. And what happened in the last year was they made a decision to move the company into a trust. All the employees have employment for life. Some of the proceeds that come from the profits will then go to help with global warming. And so a real role model. So what was his style like? Well, first, servant leaders are humble, real, and trusting. It's not about me, okay? It's about how do I help my team, how do I help my employees? Second, it seems pretty obvious, but they value others as human beings. Third, they grow and empower their people. I spent some time working with Scott McNeely at Sun, and one of the things he always said was, people are not gonna stay here forever, but I want them to know and grow as much as they can while they're here so they can come back and say, you know, you really did something great for me, okay? And that's the kind of attitude you want out of a leader. Not like, we're not gonna spend money for training. They provide, they grow and they empower their people. They let people make mistakes. With no problems with it. Second, or the next one is they provide direction. So again, it's not me ordering you to do something, but we're saying, well, what about this? What about this? And so they align on direction. They share leadership. They build enduring great organizations, and finally, they deliver extraordinary business performance. So these are organizations that have adopted servant leadership, and you can see some big names up there. So it works. When I was a little boy, grew up in Seattle, and when Nordstrom was just one store downtown on Pike Street, and we weren't particularly wealthy, and that's where we went for our shoes because we knew if the shoes were wrong, they would always take them back. So you had that brand promise. And again, you see Patagonia, Marriott, Bain, SAS. So what's the history of servant leadership? So if you go back centuries, most of the major religions, whether it's Judaism or Hinduism or Muslims or Christianity, they all had some sort of a servant kind of focus in them, because they needed to help the other people that were in the tribe, if you will. So that was where it really got started. And then kind of in the 1900s, 1900s, we had a couple examples here of Abraham Lincoln being a servant leader, where he basically gave his life and everything, you know, to help save America during the Civil War. Mother Teresa, I'm not sure how many people know Mother Teresa, but she was in India, and she helped people that were sick. And then Mahatma Gandhi as well. In the 1960s, AT&T was a very solid blue-collar company. They were known for their excellence, and they could pay people to be in human resources and, you know, study all this kind of stuff. So there's a guy named Robert Greenleaf who came up with a theory that servant leadership was an idea that they wanted to pursue. And then eventually it turned into the Greenleaf Center. So again, it was a theory, but there was no implementation plan. So what he did was he kind of went out to different AT&T offices and different places like that, and they would always talk about, you know, doing good stuff with their employees, and they'd have a day program or 2-day program, and they'd all sing Kumbaya, and then they'd forget about it, right? And so that was part of the problem, and his message was, is a great leader seen as servant first. And it also assumes that organizations as well as individuals can be servant leaders. What I discovered, I was trained as a servant leader from the time I was little. I didn't know it until I got older, but it was just kind of, it's almost like the golden rule. But what I discovered was that there's a gap between his theory and the ability to implement servant leadership within an organization. So what we're trying to do is to provide an online global community which will help develop servant leaders. It will help them develop startups and social ventures using a lean canvas model. And then there's an incubator that will follow after that where we'll actually put some seed funding into it. So case study two is Hewlett-Packard. Anybody not know about Hewlett-Packard? Okay. One of the premier technology companies ever. It started in a little garage there in Palo Alto. The two guys that started it was Dave Packard and Bill Hewlett. They were roommates at Stanford in engineering programs. And they just decided they wanted to build the company. And so what they did was they didn't say, okay, what's the first product? They said, we don't care about the first product. Let's figure out what the culture is. What are our core values? How are we going to interface with customers? What are we going to do to give back? So they did all that stuff first. And then after that, they said, okay, we'll start to figure out the products. So what happened was they liked servant leadership, but they didn't really know how to do it. And so the two of them wrote this paper called the HP Way. And that basically was a document that they distributed to all employees that said, you know, this is how this company is supposed to work. You know, you've heard the term management by walking around. That was started by them. And he expected, both of them expected themselves as well as lots of other leaders to be around on the floor and seeing what's going on. Not, you know, being punitive, but just saying, hey, how's it going? Do you have any ideas? What can we do to help you, et cetera? And so it became one of the most admired companies in the world for a number of years. So the lessons learned from Hewlett-Packard were they had two extraordinary founders, and they are both kind of natural servant leaders. They were focused on people first. They liked the servant leader theory. They did not have a way to implement it, so they invented the HP way. And they obviously built a successful enduring tech company, which is basically two companies now. One of my closest friends is leading the innovation effort at HP in the print division. So as you look at these two examples, these are kind of the, this is what we think is important as you start to build your company. First is to put people first, okay? That's really, really important. That you care about them and people trust you. You grant trust, etc. Second, we really encourage you to take a look at servant leadership. It's not for everybody. But I think there's a lot of value to it as a young startup or as a company that maybe is struggling a little bit. You know, say, okay, how can we make this better? The third thing is a term called make meeting. This was coined by John Doerr, who was at Kleiner Perkins, one of the famous VCs. Most of the big companies went through there, or Sequoia. And his position was, we want you to not only make a widget or software or something, but we want to help make the world a little better, okay? And the people that have done that have really made a difference. Fourth is to develop a vision framework with your core values, purpose, and mission. Fifth is to create a positive and trusting culture. And this is more important today than it's ever been. And finally, if you're starting out, like Jeff was talking about over here, and you want to get over there, you want to be that enduring great organization, and you'll be able to do that by doing those steps. So these are kind of the eight steps on how to build an enduring great organization. This comes from Collins. Make meaning, begin with a commitment to excellence. If you're not going to be excellent, forget it. Okay, you want to be the best, not to just be the best, but to be high quality. Adopt servant leadership, follow a clear and focused vision framework, craft a positive, trusting, and people-focused culture, get the right people on the bus in the right seat, a culture of discipline, and every team member is a servant leader. So this is what we've done with Solduck. It's been something I've been thinking about for a long time, and I finally decided to go ahead and do it. So our solution is kind of two parts. We have a website currently that's live, and it's meant to start to make people aware of servant leadership and about building enduring great organizations. The core part of it is the global online community where the people can go and get education, training, and implementation. So within there will be a leadership school, so people can go through it. You're on the online community. You could do it in person as well. Second is, then you're going to go to a social venture or a startup school that would probably do Lean Canvas. And then next step would be for the people that wanted to, we would put some money into an incubator program that would allow them to actually start to get some traction. So this is the landing page for the community. And again, our purpose is building enduring great organizations. Final thoughts, these were what I said at the beginning. I would say you want to be aware of servant leadership, and I encourage you to check it out. I'd like you to use the Collins model. I'd like you to work on creating a positive culture. And finally, hopefully, you're going to find better business results by doing this. So that's my presentation. I'd be welcome to answer some questions. Thank you.
Let's give this man a hand. All right, let's take some questions from the audience, please. If any, raise your hand so that the microphones can find you. Great.
Hello. Whoa, that's loud. I had a quick, I saw Patagonia on that. They're a really good company, and there's a lot of positivity on that company. But I saw Starbucks on there as well. And over the years, the employees have, I don't know, like talking about their dissension. So are they walking away from the servant type of management, or are they just implementing it the wrong way?
Are you agreeing that Starbucks is a servant leader company?
Yeah, okay. Like you, it was on that list of being that you said was a servant leader company. So I'm wondering, are they like implementing it wrong, or like over the years, like on social media and like articles and stuff, like more and more employees are getting less satisfied of how it's being run?
So their vice chairman is a gentleman named Howard Bahar. And he basically is one of the top servant leader evangelists in the company, and he stayed close to the company. Schultz came back to kind of clean things up when they went through a little bit of a difficult time. But I actually, the first Starbucks was in Pike Place Market, and I used to go down there when I was in high school. So it's they decided they really wanted to be about people. And when you think about their model, business model, they've created communities in communities. It's not a Starbucks, it's where you meet. If you live in Chico, you go to that Starbucks, or you go to the local place, but that's where people gather. So very much on their mind. Does that answer the question?
Sort of.
I'm just gonna add on to that. I think you're talking about like the employees have been starting to unionize and things like that because of their dissension. So I think what he was asking is like, have they not been paying attention, and has that not necessarily been at the forefront?
So
you could have somebody who's an expert at it, but it may not be disseminated through the organization as well.
Yeah, no, okay, I got it. So they're battling internally on how to do this the right way, because they are getting unionized, and so they need to make sure that they're not taking punitive action against anybody, that you continue to build that culture. And actually one of my best friends growing up, son is in the HR group at Starbucks at the headquarters. And so I've gotten a lot of back channel stuff from them about what's going on. Thank you for the question though. I think it's important. And you know, we live in a crazy time and the world is just a kind of a mess right now. And so I think the more that we can all take time and say, okay, I'm gonna show respect to everybody and have no, you know, assumptions about whether they're good or bad, just be kind, I think that goes a long way.
Absolutely. Next question, please.
Hello. Yes, I have a question about how do you, like when you're running, when you're a leader and you're doing well, your ego is humanly going to get in the way at times. What would you recommend for someone keeping their ego in check?
What was the question?
Our question has to do with, as a company grows and goes better, often the leaders will, their ego grows with it. And so she was asking for tips about how perhaps to keep the ego in check. Did I reiterate
yes,
that correctly?
Okay, that's correct.
Good. Okay, and I apologize because I just couldn't hear you. So spending all the time I did in Silicon Valley, they were all these rock star CEOs, right? And they were worried about, you know, making the most money they could, et cetera, et cetera. And there's nothing wrong with that. But servant leaders need to be developed. And there are going to be some leaders that want nothing to do with it. They're going to say, you know, if you're supposed to be able to let your employees tell you the truth, right? Give you the hard news. That's a Collins principle. And a lot of them can't do that. But when you get it where you've got the right leader or you've got a senior staff that's been trained in how to implement it and they make it part of the daily routine, that's the trick. And so with what we're doing with Solduck is when you go through the leadership school, what we're trying to do is find young entrepreneurs, and then we can also do people that are already in business, but we want to teach them about servant leadership and how to build best practices so that they're successful, they have a happy and healthy culture, the business is thriving, and the other benefit is people don't leave, you know.
I have a question, Dick. Great presentation. What's with the name? Please explain the name.
He's asking you to tell us why you chose Solduck Leadership as your name.
Oh, yeah, great question. So you actually, if you went on the website, you would learn what happened. But what happened was I grew up in Seattle. My grandfather had a dairy farm on the Olympic Peninsula in a place called Squim, on the Dungeness River where the Dungeness crabs live. And I spent a whole ton of time in Olympic National Park, climbing all those mountains, going to Boy Scout camp, going on hikes in the winter where we're going from shelter to shelter. So that's where I kind of learned a lot of my leadership stuff. And it's a beautiful place. It means sparkling waters. And the name Solduck is an indigenous name. There are about 8 tribes on the peninsula there. And it's a different name. I thought that people would kind of go, never heard of Solduck. So it's a little different. But the reason is because of the values that I learned coming out of there. And I didn't realize it till I got older how much that experience growing up impacted me. I remember if you look in the, when you get take a look at the website, if you talk about the rest of the story, it talks about me laying on the floor at our house when John Kennedy was inaugurated, and he's asking, you know, ask not what your country can do for you, but what can you do for your country? And so as a little boy, you know, I was tracking on that stuff. So it's just kind of in my DNA. I've had some people say, well, we don't know what the heck a Solduck is, but I'm right now, it's still Solduck, so.
All right, do we have any more questions from the audience? One more, okay. That'll be our last question.
Hi, so with this introduction that you had on failure, right? Like that automatically got my attention because I think failure is something that, you know, as humans, we all can relate to. something that brings us more opportunities. But with the many steps that you went over, you covered those 6 points of things that you would hope people could look into more, like positive and trusting culture. Do you think out of those kind of 6 suggestions, do you think failure falls into more of a category of positive and trusting culture? Or do you think that, you know, enduring that great operation, like, where do you think failure as it comes and goes, you know, falls into which step? Or do you think you can tie it into in your personal experience? Sorry, yeah, maybe translate that a little bit, but.
The last part of your question was actually loud enough, but unfortunately, I think we have a kind of a frequency issue with the loudness. So her question was, and you'll tell me if I'm wrong, her question had to do with, of the 6 steps that you normally, that you go through on here, where do you think failure most often resides? Is it with maybe too much trusting of the employee, or is it in operations? She's kind of asking for your opinion and your based on your experience.
I think it's the possible point of failure has happened when it's not adopted by the whole organization. It can't just be the CEO saying it's great or part of the executive team saying it's great. It has to be the rule. So, for instance, if I was your manager and you came to me and said, you know what, I'm not really happy about how things are going, I expect you to be able to have frank talk and talk to me and say, this is what I'm feeling, and oh, by the way, some of the other people think you're kind of making some mistakes. And so then you would say, okay, we're going to engage that, and we're going to say, let's have a conversation. And it involves generative leadership. Well, we're going to say, okay, so tell us what you see, okay, and then we'll share what we see. And you kind of go back and forth, but it's a safe place where you're able to do that. It also helps to have coaches. So one of the things that we're doing with Solduck is anybody that goes through our leadership program, et cetera, will get a coach or a mentor that sticks with them. After, you know, as long as they stay in the community, they'll have that. And before they start through the leadership school, we give them a mentor. When they go into the social venture or the startup lean canvas piece, we give them a coach, because the coach role is different. The coach says, okay, what do you think about this? How should we do this? Instead of do that, okay?
Thank you so much.
Good.
Yeah. Any more questions from the audience? Did I miss a hand? No, I didn't. Oh, great. Let's give Dick Gourley a big hand, please.
Thank you.